The first time I heard about the arsenic issue was in 1998, when a geologist from Calcutta came to a vault, and he had some little brochures that were pretty wrinkled and didn't look very convincing, but showing these horrible pictures of people with lesions and amputated limbs and things like that. So that was the first time I heard about the issue. And when essentially a number of us in Colombia, we started to say, well, let's try to do something about that. So these were initially mostly earth scientists, geochemists, and hydrologists. And then coincidentally, there was a group at the Leiden School of Public Health in Colombia that knew that there would be a call for large proposals from something called the Superfund Research Program to look to investigate the issue of the health effects of arsenic exposure. And the reason this was expected is because the standard for arsenic in drinking water at the time was still 5 micrograms per liter, 50 ppb. The World Health Organization was lower at 10. And the US was sort of torn between on what to do about this. And so that's what apparently people realized, that essentially not enough was known about the health effects. And so we knew, substantial amount of money was there. We also knew that the Superfund program required us a collaboration between health scientists and natural scientists, engineers of some sort. And so it was a rather special opportunity. And I think that without that particular event, I probably would not be sitting here with you and studying climate change, impact on coastal circulations, things that I never used to do before that. So it certainly had a big impact and has been very exciting. So maybe I'll stand up here for the next few minutes and start by saying, well, yes, we've been working on this for almost 2 decades, and some of you might say, well, that's not a very good sign. How come you're still studying the same problem? Maybe you'll agree there are some mitigating circumstances, but obviously it's a huge problem, and it's going to take a while to address it. I'm very glad that a number of you are interested in some intermediate-scale treatment of some sort, because I need your feedback. Essentially, what you will see is that our approach, built over the years, is essentially a zero-maintenance approach, at least a zero-human maintenance approach. Essentially, it's letting the Earth do the treatment for you and exploring those pockets of groundwater that are low in arsenic. Of course, this then raises the issue of how long you come from that and things like that. And I think it's fair to say that what we've learned over the past couple of decades is that if you do monitor periodically, I think this is not a bad approach. It won't work everywhere. The work that Mike was telling us about, if you are in a village where there's not a single safe low arsenic well, there's no choice, you have to treat. But our sort of impression is that a lot could be done without treatment. And then rather than an engineering or a science problem, it becomes more of a social. How do you get people to share wells that are low in arsenic? That's essentially what we're going to try to present. I think that this presentation would not have been interesting at all for you, much less if, Prabhat isn't going here, hadn't been here, we've been working together for a number of years, and would give you the economics aspect. And also described for you what sort of we see as the next steps in terms of field studies. We are both rather field oriented. All right, so if you need to contact us, this is where we start this correctly. There we go. So first, the sort of the scale of the problem. This is a map that was produced by Peter Ravenscroft a number of years ago from UNICEF. And I think it's well done. Essentially, it outlines all the sort of floodplain areas in South and Southeast Asia where potentially you could have a problem because so many people install these inexpensive wells. And the colors don't reflect sort of the severity of the arsenic issue. What they reflect instead is population density. Impact, obviously, you do think about that. And blowing our own horn just a little bit here, just to show you where over the past couple of decades we've conducted field studies. That's the yellow boxes. So it includes our main sort of study area remains Bangladesh, but we've done things together with each other in Bihar, also in Punjab as well. So this is what I'm going to be talking to you about. If I had to pick one slide to summarize the approach, it would be something like that. So this shows you, at the village level, the distribution of arsenic in Punjab on both sides of the border. We have a paper on review, a nice collaboration with Abita Farouk from Al Azhar University and Charles Allah, testing on the Indian side of the border. We have something from the work of Chandra again and with Prabhat and Bihar. And this is really where we started working a couple of years ago. Let me explain to you what the pioneering grants mean. They don't quite mean exactly the same thing. What this one's probably the simplest. So I mentioned the 10 micrograms per liter, that's the World Health Organization guideline. The proportion of the pie that corresponds to that is the blue part. Like, so for instance, in this particular village in Pakistan, still within the Indus plains, there was essentially no well at the time, arsenic. The green area is between 10 and 50 ppb. So India has sort of mixed standard. I mean, it was for a long time 50. Now it's supposed to be 10, but there are sort of some areas on the options that are 50 is acceptable. That's the point that I understand. So from a health point of view, I'll just tell you, the Netherlands, where I happen to be from, is now aiming for a 1 ppb standard. So the health effects, even at 10, are still significant enough in some countries. And then the red portion means over 50, it can be up to 1,000 ppb. So in other words, 100 times the current WHO guideline. So an enormous effect. And so in all these areas, you could have a sizable portion of red. Like you have it here, you have it here. The very here's a here, there was lab testing. To a large extent, so essentially for free, all the wells were tested. Here, we were trying to sell tests, so the gray portion is the part of the village that didn't, the households didn't want to buy the test. We won't get into the details now, but so keep that in mind. And here, it was after a certain particular government survey, and here, the yellow portion means that you didn't know the status of their well. So it means slightly different things. What's the main point? The main point is you will not see here a single pie diagram that is red. And that's, I think, the starting point. That means someone, these are mostly private wells, is lucky and has a single well. Is that an opportunity? Can one either target the same aquifer for a public source or sort of share that source? This is the essence of our approach and how to get there. We don't know 100%, but if this is the case in the vast majority of countries, not all, but suppose even if it's 70%, that means that you could achieve a lot without water treatment. That's what we're talking about. And now we'll sort of decompose that a little bit. Let me give you some of the health effects and some of the history of how the health effects were discovered. The sort of two heroes in this field are Casey Shaha, who was a dermatologist in Kolkata. And I think he's the person I remember seeing. Was he and the team of bicycles driven sort of test. So they were riding bicycles and offering to test wells for people in West Bengal. But this was only after he's the one who, looking at people with skin lesions and amputations, he did it in front of us. He showed me, I was looking through a standard textbook. And then I said to him, this looks like arsenicosis. We had never faced arsenicosis before. It's only after the symptoms have been discovered, identified, that people started testing wells. And the other person who really played a huge role in this is Dipankar Chakraborty. He's a remarkable man, very driven, very intense as well. Doesn't make friends with everybody when they don't recognize that there's a serious problem there. But he's the one who really managed to test, you know, several hundred thousand wells over a decade period, starting in West Bengal, expanding into Bangladesh, upstream towards Bihar and other states. So he's really a hero in this story. They did it from the university starting in the 1980s. This here, our, I think on the health side, our main contribution has been that in the following. We recruited about 12,000 people. We tracked them for a decade. We knew their arsenic exposure because my group had tested the wells. And there was no direct connection. I mean, essentially, whether you're rich or poor, whether you eat well or not, there was no connection between that and the level exposure. So to some extent, it was a randomized experiment. And what we found is that within this more than 12,000 people, only 500 deaths that were reported over a certain period, it turned out that the likelihood of a high exposure group was double that translate that in many ways to what the levels are of exposure like Bangladesh, my colleagues, I will be able to reproduce that calculation for you on the spot now, essentially attribute 20% of today's mortality, total mortality in Bangladesh, to arsenic exposure. Some parts of Bangladesh government still don't recognize this. They will say, this is nonsense. Not, I mean, there's one government minister who happens to be in charge of the ministry under which the Department of Public Health and Judea falls, has publicly said on TV, not a single person dies from arsenic. The people, you know, from this department are much more collaborative, and we work with them very much. But obviously, it's a constraint. My colleague Joe Graziano, he also showed that children who are exposed, told to us about school, or at least the various tests that you would give them, intellectual function is diminished. Birth outcomes are negatively impacted by arsenic exposure on the mother. There are some economic consequences. Maybe from that, you could say something about that.
So, there's not only health impact of actually, there is a direct implication for the productivity of people, how many hours they can put at work, and how much they can earn. And again, like affect the household welfare in all senses. So, some of these like economic papers look into it, and let me remind you, these estimates are not coming from just correlation, these are quasi-experimental methods which they use. And they found like 9% loss in household income, labor supply in terms of number of hours worked by the adult in a household which is drinking water from arsenic contaminated well, and they reduced by 8%, and there is huge mental health burden, which is to the order of the order that if the government wants to compensate people, it would be almost annual average income of households in Bangladesh. So with that, one thing is important that it's this contribution level, which is very obvious, and we talk about that. But it also like how much exposure people get. Like if a child starts drinking water from day one, it is going to affect him or her much more than someone who is just drinking it one or two times. You know. So that's where the opportunity is. That whatever we can do to reduce the margin there, and switching is one aspect which is mentioned. We are trying to focus more on rural areas, especially where we realize in India that piped water supply would be the ideal for sure, but neither states have resources and nor we have time to wait for that kind of infrastructure. And second, like whatever public health system, like where you want, you can diagnose these kind of discriminations and all these problems and link it to arsenic, these are not really robust. That
So we'll focus now on the situation in India. Sorry, that's right. We're going to
One more point here is that it's very short. That how many people are affected by this arsenic contaminated, like high arsenic exposure in drinking water, is not very certain. We don't really know. There is one report from this international group. This quote was there that 70 million households, but there are like other instances where they say that we don't really know. And then there is this article which is like less than 30 days old in India. They talked about 200 million people in India which are affected by this.
Yeah, I got to read that article like the other week, and the way they did the survey seemed pretty questionable to me, and talking with someone else.
The Next Media article?
Yeah, because it just came out like last week.
I understand.
Overblown.
Yeah, it seems like overblown. Yeah, that's why I wrote this.
Because I saw it like last week, and I was like,
right.
21 states is like abnormally high.
Yes, and they do some sort of aggregation, and that's why their number is really high.
That's right. They essentially don't multiply the population by the fraction.
They cannot because they don't know the ratio.
Right. But you know, even 70 million is plenty to do something about it. So, all right. So, I'll tell you. Essentially, I've given you an idea of the spatial distribution of arsenic in a village using the pie diagram. I'm now going to show you a little bit more detail on that. This is our main study about the area in Bangladesh, Al-Azhar in Bangladesh, where we have been about 20 kilometers east of Dhaka to the Pekka River. And this happens to be about 50,000 field kit tests. several years ago. And there are two features. So there's a map. So this is, if you fly over it, if you have a vision for that, you would see a combination of blue and red and green dots following the scale that I suggested. And the below is simply the depth section. So the longitudes of these, each of these dots correspond. But I'm adding, but I've replaced essentially the y-axis with the depth axis. So this is if you were to look at it, from the side, so it was the oceanographic section. And so there are a couple of features. If you look at it from above, you can see that some villages are not very much affected, and others they have a very high yield. That's similar to what the pie graph. And there's some regional features, and geology is really the underlying part of that. How old is the sediment? Has it been flushed of arsenic over time? How sandy is it, or how covered is it with a clay layer that prevents the flushing? These are the factors. I'm not going to get into the details of that. What is also striking at the depth section here is that you see that essentially these are mostly government installed deep wells, so deep, the depth is somewhat arbitrary, but they define as about 150 meters. And you can see that the vast majority of these deep wells is low. It's low in arsenic, and the high arsenic wells, but it's a much higher number, so these are the private wells. It's a slightly different technology, less expensive, the hand flood methods, so those here are a very large fraction of high arsenic wells. So this is the key feature for a solution. So if somehow the resources were there to provide these, or these wells, the population would be able to know it's exposed. And so 1,000, deep wells exposed here, I mean, that's great. I should point out, just for completeness, these triangles, they were initially red as well, and then it turns out that the wells were not as deep as was claimed by the manager of the well, or even the government, because we lowered sending video camera to check where the screen is. And then you can see there's a second screen that's much shallower. Well, it will draw water from there, and therefore it will look, maybe the well is that deep, but if there's a screen here, it will draw water from the higher screen. And this is essentially three villages close together, painted clear, where the deep aquifer, where the wells don't leak, and where they don't have a shallow stream, and there is high arsenic. We don't know why. Maybe related to pumping, we don't know. I don't want to hide this because I want to, whenever we say something, it's going to, we think it could be a solution, say 80 or 90% of the cases, but we don't want to claim it's always the micro. There's an area that sort of crossed the border of West Bengal and Bangladesh, in particular, the latter, which is shore approximately Santipur in West Bengal, where even the deep well is much more consistently high arsenic. And so, in those areas, you need the treatment. In Alai Hazar, you obviously do not apply much. All right. Now, my first paper on this sort of type of data set was very simple. I just learned about ArcGIS, and the calculation I made was very simple. I said, okay, let me calculate how far from each the red dot is the nearest safe weapon. Because it looked like it is. And so even though I can tell that over this area 50% of the wells are unsafe for red, it turns out that 90% of the people live within 100 meters of the safe well. Very simple calculation. But that really opened the eyes to us on what could be done without doing that. Most people have neighbors that have the safe well. It doesn't mean it's easy to share them with my panel. It is the reality on the ground. And this is, we've done similar calculations for other spending areas, and it's by and large the reality. After, I guess in 2006, we wrote up a policy piece for Science magazine. And based on our survey data, but also some UNICEF data, we calculated what the impact was of various forms of treatment back in 2006, and if anything, for reasons I'll get to, I'm afraid that now the situation is worse than it was in 2006. The government had just completed a big national testing campaign of 5 million wells in Bangladesh. 100,000 deep wells had been installed, and so we estimated that based on the proportion of people who had actually switched from an unsafe well to a neighboring safe well, we measured that in our study area, but also UNICEF did that, and we decided it was about a third. So a third of the people, without encouragement, it turns out a third of the people, based on test results and communicated results, were willing to switch to a neighboring well. So we said that, okay, we had about a third of people exposed, people no longer exposed based on that. The government had installed enough T2 wells to affect another 12%. And although much of the attention and the news and all that is on more technological solutions, pipe water systems, rainwater collection, pond sand filters, we worry about microbial issues there, dug wells, and our arsenic removal units, a big prize had been awarded to someone who worked very hard on it. If you add up the numbers, this is the sliver on the pie that these methods really were having on exposure. And so that's why we've essentially been focusing on these two approaches. When it's so easy.
Because of your study, the information delivered people.
Right. So, that's right. So when we did our first round of testing, we labeled 6,000 wells with black and gave the concentration and the status of the well. We did, our health team did a follow-up survey and asked, what well are you drinking from? And so based on that, we came up with a proportion of people who switched to another one. And this was verified also by measuring the urine and the arsenic in the urine. So we had an independent, you know, people may tell you what you want to hear, but we also verified. So that's how we found it. So merely providing the information has already a big impact.
So it's because of that we can shift it?
Yes, well, one way to test that is that we also look at, okay, how about the low exposure people? 1% shift. That's a good question. Yeah. That's our problem. Okay, well, we don't have 100% reduction exposure, so there's still a tall order. So how, what are the obstacles that we've identified over the years? And I won't make it too long, but there are three of them. One of them is lack of well testing. The other one is, you know, why you know, if even if the well is there, that doesn't mean the person switches. And then on the government side, these deep wells are often not located where they have the. So I'm going to go a little bit into detail of those, using essentially the same graphs, and then it will soon be robust turn to make this point. So in our area, we did our survey in 2001, and then by chance was a government survey at the same. And 2003 on this histogram is, you know, somewhere between here. So the reason I say that is essentially is we went back to the area and we asked people, what is the status of the well? And, you know, they could say it's safe, unsafe, or we don't know. And so the unknown is in yellow here. So since we did our planning survey, and this was the installation, so we organized this by installation here, people do know that. And so, since we did our survey in 2000 and the government did another one, it's not so surprising that the yellow portion is very small. You know, people may even forget it to be tested. But what you can see is that many more wells were installed later and they were never tested. And so that's why the proportion of this yellow bar keeps growing. I can tell you I've done since. I was shocked when I saw that. So, we learned two things is that. It was confirmed there's no testing service. People are pretty good at remembering the status of their health. We also do this own testing to check that there. But they have no way to turn if they install a new well. And they do install a new well for a couple of reasons. I mean, one is that, you know, a well may fail on the screen, the pipe may break or disconnect. But also often for convenience. Oh, I'd like a second well next to the kitchen here, for example, like that. We did find that many more people install new wells in areas where arsenic was relatively low. So people don't know that they don't want to waste their money either. So since this big testing campaign of 5 million wells in Bangladesh, there hasn't been any survey. And so we estimate that on the order of 2/3 of the wells were installed after that survey. And so 2/3 of the 160 million population of Bangladesh, they don't know their status of their well. So how can we overcome that? This is another illustration. This was on the well switch. This is an example that happens to be from the this happens to be a well that is unsafe. You can see this person here within, you know, a few 50 meters, there are several wells that are safe. So there's not enough testing. How would we overcome that? The product is going to see. There's also not, let's assume the testing service is there. There's still not enough switching. This goes back to your earlier question. So this particular study, which was outside where we have doctors and reinforcements, so it's really more representative of the country. This is after a government testing program, and what you can see, half the wells were really unstable in areas. And this is the proportion, about less than a third of people had switched there. Most of those, I know, were switching to a safe well, some to wells that went to a status, and some, oddly enough, still to a well that was high enough. But so it's not perfect news, but it's not hopeless either. I mean, just providing the information is really valuable. And here another example, right? They knew the well was safe. In this case, we're taking 22% search. So information here is very valuable. But this is the average. This is to give you an idea. This on this axis is for each village that we study in this particular location. So it's not our own study area on purpose. We measure the average distance to the nearest state well. We know from experience that people typically don't walk beyond 100 meters. You know, and especially if it's a public well, actually they're willing maybe to go a bit further. But in our experience. So let's say that 100 meters is sort of a cutoff. It's not realistic. I mean, when we do it in Africa on a daily basis under different circumstances, but from what we understand in South Asia, what is really striking is essentially this range. Right. So obviously the switch on average declines, so the distance, no surprise there, which is a simple regression. But at equal average distance from the nearest safe well, or say 30 meters, you can have no switching, or you can have 100% switching. Why is that? So spatially there's no difference, there must be something. So that's where we get into the social economics. Why is one village responding? But this is also the opportunity. We know this is possible. How can we correct? Encourage these black parts to go up this thing. Now we're into this sort of the last viewpoint is switching will go so far. You know, it's essentially without government intervention, other than perhaps the testing. It's not going to work everywhere. Deep wells are about 10 times more expensive. It's about $1,000 in Bangladesh rather than $100 for a shallow well that maybe most households have at some point. So clearly there's a role for the deep wells. How have they been allocated? And this came again from a simple GIS exercise. So this is a close-up of a somewhat random area of our study, a random portion of our study in Bangladesh. It shows you villages with red wells, the blue wells, and the green. And the larger circles, I hope you can see some of them, are circles with 100 meter diameter. And I'm trying to represent with that center all the deep well. And the idea is that is probably the area where, sort of the catchment area of that well. So this one here, for instance, has several dozen red wells within. So you can sort of score it on that basis. And so we calculate based on this distribution of deep wells that in our LSR, 1,000 wells out of 50,000 total number of wells were enough to bring about 30% of the red wells within 100 meters of the public well. You say, oh, that's good news. But it turns out that if these wells had been allocated differently, it could have been closer to 75%. And so I made a little hypothetical calculation here, just for simplicity. Essentially what I did is, okay, I have 1,000 wells here, that I created an array of essentially wells that touch each other, and you can see the patterns, they're regular here, it's a simplification. And let me just calculate how many red wells there's those, and then take the top 1,000. When I do that, I come up with 75%. And you can see why. Look at this village, for instance. There are about 20 deep wells in a single village. Obviously, a waste of resources compared to the other one here, which it turns out doesn't belong to the same political party, the Legion, not a single deep well. So clearly, there's a misallocation of public resources that should be fixed. And we have some ideas. That's just a graph from my sponsor. So, we have some ideas on the lack of well testing, on the insufficient well switching, and the sort of optimal allocations. This is my last slide. I can expand on this if you wish, but we have become firm believers in field kits. Going to a lab, the sample has to travel, the result has to be brought back to the household. You get 5% precision if you have a good lab. But why do we care about 5% when the levels are 1, 10, 100, 1,000? 50%, we're already doing pretty good. The kid does better than 50%, I can tell you that. You know, essentially, we see that in typical distribution. If you have a well-trained person, as an example, a team of 10 women, and you know, they should work for a year and a half, I would say that 90% of the wells are correctly classified. And we do this in three columns. We say relative to the original guideline, relative to still Bangladesh, and above that. And most of the mix-up occurs in this intermediate range. In our big survey, we didn't have a single well that was labeled blue that should have been red, or red that should have been blue. So that's, so we emphasize that, and they will come up back. But also now we essentially use smartphones. It's very easy to have an app, record all the data, it helps quality control, you have GPS coordinates, you can really check how the quality of that work. The other point is how to encourage well switching, and Prabhat had some really nice ideas about that. These are the blankets in India, I think, so this is from Bihar, we'll tell you about that. The last point I'll make here with the smartphones is something that we're trying to reduce, and at least the government of Bangladesh is excited about this. Once you've done the blanket survey, you can calculate a potential score for any location. Like you just go and say, what's the calculate? How do you avoid the overlapping wells? Essentially, you correct the score. You said, okay, we'll see how many unsafe wells are within 100 meters and subtract any of the wells that are already within 100 meters of an existing well. And so we are going to propose that if that score is made public, the local government better justify deviating from a ranking of potential sites, public sites, whatever you have, and explain that to the public and the voters, of course. So we think that the combination of, say, this is 19th century chemistry with smartphones, more recent, but in their rather basic fashion, could really help overcome some of these things. All right, brother. Thank you.
So, let us clearly explain the last point. It is something economists care a lot about, that optimal allocation of resources. And I really hope what is trying to do is make fun of it would happen. Now, let's talk about. So it's like this. So, once you have a different kind of inefficiency in the system because of political, affiliation based allotment of these deep wells or some, like say, bribing or whatever way, then you will see the deep wells not in the right location because the priorities are different, right? But you can calculate a score that which area, which location should be preferred, in what order, in the rank order it should be, if you look at this kind of scores of like how many people are get affected, going to get better water once this deep well comes in. So that is like more optimal in the sense that like for the same amount of money, you are going to probably improve the allocation by like 50%. I'm just making this number, but it could be 50% or 20% or 80%. And that if you...
Yes, sir, actually save wells that you're digging.
Yeah, you're digging deep wells, which I'm saying.
That's right. And in the score enters only the unsafe wells.
So let me talk about the research agenda we are working on. And as you've seen, for a long time, and I started pretty recently. We have identified what are the steps, and we have our objective in mind. But I'm not going to start the objective. It will become clear when I describe all these things, all the steps. The first is where to test. So we have identified some of the states in India where sarcenic problem is high, and where we expect certain level of cooperation from the local community and the government. And how to test. So this is one thing. That there are two different methods you can think about, like sending water sample to lab or using this test kit, just sending a surveyor to door to door or like knocking at door to door and recording this with a mobile phone. So this is what we are going to use, this field kits, and try to do a blanket campaign so that all the wells in a given village can be sent. Now the key question here is like how to increase test coverage to a level where we can see that all the wells are tested. And there are a lot of ideas here, and one broad category here is that how we can incentivize these testers who are doing this testing. It's very easy to think about it like, okay, fine, like you can go and test all the wells, but when you go in the village, it's very different to even to identify which parts are tested, which are not. which are not, and we need to put a lot of effort in there, and that's what we learned from our field work in Bihar as well. So one thing we try to do, and this third one is we talk about this here, is that charging household for this, and the reason here is that to develop, just see that if there is a first stage for a potential market for this district or this like test entrepreneur. So I can show you the result in a bit. And there are all other aspects where we are thinking about using this network of government employees or school teachers, somewhat similar to the portfolio model, right? That because the nature of the problem is similar. You have, someone has to go door to door and either test it or give the polio vaccine. So we can draw from all India's factors there. And then there's some other economic stuff where what kind of incentives are going to be more useful. So this is what we did in Bihar in 2012 and 2015. And we tried to split the demand curve, how much households are willing to pay for these tests. And we used a field experiment to divide villages in different price in 10, 20, 30, 14, 50 rupees. And what we found is that demand is very steep. As you will expect that at zero price, almost 100% will buy it. So it is very steeper than what you see here in terms of the curve. And it gets flatter and flatter once you start increasing the price of the test. The price of the test, including the kit as well as the fit person and what play cards we were giving, was almost four times of this 50 rupees price. So it would be even much lower if we put everything together, the manpower cost and the test cost.
One test.
So basically, what we did is that we had 25 villages. In 5 villages, we offered the same test for 10 rupees. In 5 villages, we offered the test for 50 rupees.
The actual cost of test kit is
I think, comparable to 50 rupees or a little less.
The materials of the kit is 30 cents, dollar cents. So I guess about 20 rupees.
Yeah, about 20 rupees. But if you take everything together, like a manpower and going there,
and quality control,
what you can do at black art, becomes around 200. Yes.
Did you collect other information on the demand? Because I feel like in regions, if someone knows there's lots of arsenicosis in a region, maybe they assume that there's.
Yeah, so that's why we do randomized control trial. So all the villages are from the same area, right? And we divide these villages into different price bins randomly, right? So we of course we collect information like how much variation is there, but as long as randomization is complete and balanced. People are more equally likely to know about that speaking in the first 5 minutes as they are even likely in the last 5 minutes.
Knowing or family members with the arsenic?
Yeah, again, it's a randomization to take care of that. I will talk about that in a bit.
And also, in terms of the manifestation, the lesions show up on just a few percent of the population, right? Even in the most affected villages. So,
it's very common knowledge, though.
Right, but the visible signs are limited.
Yeah, but I mean, like, you can just ask them and they'll show up and say, here, buddy. The other question here in terms of who should test, PhDs have done like, millions of tests across India. Have you looked? The database is a little bit wonky to work with, but they do include address locations that are difficult to parse. You can't just Google it. But there's already millions of tests across India. Have you guys looked at those records?
I'm not aware of any database which is like readily available.
PhD data set is not a kind of blanket data set.
Well, no, so it's not blank, but I'm saying it exists already. Like,
yeah,
millions. I could see a million. Millions? Multiple millions?
The CSV file we have is like 2 gigabyte. I forget how many. I think it's, yeah, a few. That's not just ours, but there's also fluoride, iron.
There is, a database.
But
with PhD, the challenge is the habitations that are tested over a period of time are not consistent.
I see.
Yeah. So the habitation itself will change.
Well, they combine address information also.
But that data is, I remember, it is 2007, 2008 data, not current data.
They have, you can choose the year you want.
You can choose the year. You are saying current data is also available. Yeah, so the latest data that I know of, because I have recently.
They keep adding to the database.
In 2007, 2008, I was very critically seeing those PhD data after, let's say, 6 months, 1 year, that signal may also change. Someone has to remove that signal and make it green.
Yes.
So, somewhat inconsistent is what I call it.
There is inconsistency, and that is what, as a network, we are trying to look at over a period of 10 years. How has this inconsistency evolved, and why there are inconsistencies?
Right.
Why do the habitations itself change over a period of 1 year?
Right.
But one thing is that there are a lot of efforts, there are a lot of courses there for doing this.
Exactly.
This is like official level.
So, one more motivation here is not only sampling some of the tests, right? Let's just explain that we want to have a blanket testing of all the private wells. Many times, machine is more interested in community wells, and then we will not be able to take advantage of the switching potential we have within the pillar. So, I'm going to describe one proposal we are working on the how to socially incentivize sharing among households within a village. And here is some results from recent fieldwork in Bangladesh. And we have a group here where they only did testing. Then the group B here where they asked household. So think about arsenic as kind of a lottery. Nobody knows whether their well is safe or unsafe, right? Because there is no testing there. There is no testing market available. You can have some average, mean value of arsenic in the village based on maybe like one community or two community wells, but that's all, right? So it's kind of lottery, and if you can ask people to come together to form a group before this lottery is revealed, and then like have this kind of informal commitment among themselves that we will share our water, and this is more likely to result into higher switching rate, right, than the counterfactual where you don't do this kind of research, right? So that's what we have in group B here, that households come together to form some informal groups for water sharing. And C is like it's just testing with the play card posted on the web. And what we see here is that the switching rate increases almost becomes twice of 30% because of group sharing, and there is also a jump because of the play card. So what we do not know here is how much complementarity is there between group sharing as well as play card. So that is one part of one test. And what leads to what kind of transactions or social cost reduction is leading to this higher kind of switching, that is the other area of investigation. In the India context, basically what we learned from our field work in Bhojpur district is that people are likely to hide some of this black card. They are less likely to share some of these with other households, because we have caste barriers and other kind of barriers. It is more salient than what it would be in Bangladesh. So those things invite more investigation, how we can have a design where we can inculcate the kind of within community sharing of resources even before this test result is issued.
Generally, the villages could, they may not know exact extent of, pollutants or these chemicals, etc. But they would know which well is, relatively better, or which well is relatively worse off in terms of the water characteristics.
Right.
Did you find that kind of...
So we ask people, how do you think about your well, whether it's safe or unsafe? In our surveys before we do testing, and there's no clear correlation, because it's like people can think about either this is obvious, or any kind of sediment which you can visually see. But for arsenic, which is like tasteless and colorless, it's very difficult for even them to figure it out that it is contributed with arsenic. Yeah. And that's what we see in our surveys.
Some
some work in Punjab, like at Chandler, I've been doing some tea at fluoride.
And nitrate.
And nitrate, yes.
And, but for the arsenic, in terms of, you know, it's a natural occurrence, right? It's not pollution in that sense, but it's man-made. I think in terms of the health effects that are invisible, you know, someone dies from cardiovascular disease, you know, it's not linked to arsenic. More people die from cardiovascular disease than from, you know, lesions or cancers to arsenic. So we think that that is still the dominant one. If there was another one that probably will become relevant in future years, it's manganese in one. And, you know, a low arsenic well will not necessarily be low in manganese. When I talk to public health people, they say, let's focus on the arsenic. That is by far the one that has the biggest impact on health. Manganese, yes, but it's just not repairable. So you don't want to essentially be too distracted by other parameters, other than microbial. You still don't want to have any microbial contamination.
Yes, you usually see the leadership report published on 2008. So they have a ratio that more than 50 million children die every year.
Yeah, but the tumors are generally low in microbial contamination. They're not perfect. We have a number of papers on that topic. And in fact, it's the shallow, low arsenic wells are more likely to be microbially contaminated, which is why we are focusing on the deep wells now.
Do you think there is value in also checking for iron? Because what Mike just presented, arsenic and iron being concurrent.
Yeah, but it's not a good enough predictor. You'd be fooling yourself if you think that a high iron well will necessarily be high in arsenic or a low iron well will necessarily be low in arsenic.
I don't think he's talking about from an arsenic perspective,
yeah,
the desirability of using
sure.
In terms of, like, you could have a
sign.
I mean, so of course we can have all these tests, but it helps if we are focused on one, given the resources when you have like a fixed pot of money to maximize the number of wells tested. So this is what we did, and because it's easy to talk like, okay, let's go into a village and ask people to farm crops, and then we will do the testing, and then we will expect that they will be sharing water. But it's difficult to operationalize it. So we did a feasibility pilot in 5 villages in Bihar last year, and what we did is like we gave these water sharing coupons. We call it like water sharing coupons here, and here it says that like main in Chapakal ka paani aapke saath baantne ke liye samadhu. That I am agreeing that I will share water with you, and then you have a name of the other numbers, the other people where you can just like a bill number, you can write here who you have shared your water with. So we gave them 5 such coupons, asked them to keep one for themselves, and extend to 4 remaining with their
with an ID.
So it helped them form a flexible group. So I can share my coupon with you, and I can share probably with you, but you both may not be sharing coupon itself for any kind of reason, any kind of social media you may have among yourself. So that's what we thought, like to make it as flexible as possible, no structure imposed by us. And this is one picture where like, people were very happy with this. They really like this concept of having this agreement, of like having this assurance that if my well turns out to be high in arsenic, then it's not something I need to worry too much about because my neighbor has already agreed with me that we are going to share water, and there is likelihood that one of us in this 5 we are going to have safe water. So
how does this work? Because I mean, water sharing, water is a daily need, requirement. So if there were flexible arrangements,
as a discussion you were having yesterday, that these compounds are many a times having this hand pumps outside of their main housing, right? So it's not such a difficult and painful process to allow someone to take a bucket of water from the hand pump. And in some areas, people are really very, you know, generous about sharing water. Like one bucket of water is not really going to bring your groundwater level down, right? People know that. Like there are, for irrigation, when you don't need a lot of water, then there are markets in UP and Punjab. But for this kind of like drinking and cooking water, need one bucket of water is not going to make any. So that is one, but of course the question is like why people share, so and why people do philanthropy or why people do charity. So it's like this kind of like some kind of social transition is happening here, right? If I am giving water to you, I would expect that you will stand with me in my mind, like when I have some bad times. So these are the existing systems within the village which we are trying to exploit to provide a solution without any having any extra investment for deep well or pipe water supply or a treatment plant. And these are the black art which we have here. This is like arsenic surakshit pani, arsenic safe water. Arsenic surakshit pani again, but it says that you can drink but moderately. So the message you have to give is that it is moderately unsafe or moderately safe, the way you phrase it. And this one is you should not drink it. There is a cross here on the glass that you should not drink it. And this is above 50 particles per million or microgram per million.
Why did you choose the color green?
Why did you use green?
So the colors come from Bangladesh, and I had initially picked the obvious sort of traffic light colors of green, yellow, and red. But the Bangladesh standards today is still 50, and they said if you make this yellow, you are inconsistent with national policy. So I had no choice in Bangladesh, and without really thinking it through, Chan and I probably decided to keep the same. So it's no more. In India, one could make this yellow and this green if you think that would make a big difference.
So this is what we are trying to do. We will take this formula group sharing, and we will also have this black art and try to see that if we have both together, how much switching we can expect, we can find after this. And if, as we saw in Bangladesh, it would be if we can really reach like 60% or 70% consistently in many locations in India, that would be a big change.
Sorry, I'm just curious. What all the five villages from Bhojpur?
The means?
No, but all the five
locations
from Bhojpur district.
Yeah, all five. They were very, very close to those 25 villages which we showed the map. So that was a brief introduction, and this is what we do. I mean, as I mentioned, that we do field experiment, and by field experiment I mean randomized controlled trial to take care of any kind of differences, heterogeneity. There may be because of people's characteristics, their income, their education, their knowledge about arsenic or any kind of government intervention. What we do is like we take a bunch of villages, depending on how much sample size we need, we divide it randomly in different arms, and we provide the policy change or the treatment only in like one arm, and we keep other arms as a control to measure the impact of the treatment we are giving.
Yeah.
So this is like very similar to how medicine pills are tested in labs before they are marketed and then they are used by humans. So this has been used in development economics a lot in last 1.5 decades successfully. And as I said, it has been removing all different kind of biases and critically provide critical counter factor to estimate the treatment time. So the design here would be that we have a total 90 medium sized villages, like say 100 households in each, and that comes about 10,000 wells. We divide the 90 villages into three different groups. One is only the control group, where we only do testing, blanket testing, and we are not doing any kind of group sharing or any kind of black art. The second one, we have these three farm groups where people exchange these coupons, and the third, we have these three farm groups as well as this black art, so that we can see what is the complementarity between having both of these treatments together. What we do is that we go to this, we do baseline surveys, we map out like all the household there, we have the baseline question, how much you know about arsenic problem, and try to make them convince them for these groups in these two arms. Then we do this intervention and testing where we test the water sample from their hand pump right there at their doorstep and tell them the result. Put the black card in there in the third arm, and then you have an end-line survey after 3-4 months where we go and ask whether you have fished to a well. If you have fished, what is the well ID so that we can know where exactly they are getting their water from. One nice thing here is because we can track where how people are exchanging those coupons, so we know who all are in the same group and who are not, and that will help us in kind of separating whether the increase in switching is more because of this extra reduction in the social cost or reduction in barrier from switching, or it is more because of certain type of awareness when people readily start switching even beyond their goals.
So what's the difference between one and two as information?
So two has
information.
So all of them have information about the test result. Two has this pre-forming group thing where the coupon sharing.
So three also have
that, as well as they have a black card which makes it more salient. So the
black
the placard makes it public, just partially public. I would say maybe that's the.
I mean, it's making it more salient, you know.
That's
right.
Right.
And you may know the status of your well, that is your private information, but you may not know the status of my well. And when a placard is there, it becomes much easier for you to know the status of neighboring wells. Right?
Yeah.
How is a medium sized village defined?
How is
a medium sized
village? Yeah, it's like about 100 households I'm consuming here.
100?
Yeah, and about 100. Basically, it will be somewhere 70 to 150 households.
The placard is not a legend. It's a, it's saying we haven't found a way to make a placard of this type for less than a dollar, so for 50 to 60 rupees in Bangladesh or in India. So that's more. It's 3 times more expensive than the material cost of the kit. So
yeah.
You want to do the placards only if they really make a difference. That's what we
can do. Because otherwise, you can pitch 3 times more wells for the same amount of money.
That's right.
You want to see how complicated it becomes when the information is there.
Yeah, so you want to see, like, once you have this group sharing agreement and at the same time you have a salient information about the status of all the wells in the village, how much switching happens and how it happens either within the group or outside of the group. Right.
Yes, so for the three formed groups, do you also take advantage of the existing institutions in the village or in the, because like you have self-help groups as the biggest network,
right?
Women being the
right. So we have not thought of doing that, and it's very difficult to know, exactly like where the self-help groups are more present and where they are less. But
you know it because there's a whole database from which you can access.
I see.
The entire SSG network.
I see. In a particular village. Right? But I mean, one thing we wanted to make sure here to make it as flexible as possible. You know, if we rely on any kind of a structure people already have, because they have, then it becomes more restrictive. And that's where, like, they are totally free to rely on their self-help group members, friends, for exchanging coupons. We are not telling them, right? We are giving these coupons, everybody. It was a success in the sense that whosoever got these coupons, all of the households were able to exchange at least a few of these coupons. Or I think maximum of them, like most of them, were able to exchange all of them. So, in a world where we are finding this very restricted, that they are not finding ways to exchange coupons, that will be super helpful. But yeah, you know, from that the strength of this flexible approach where we are not really restricting coupons.
Also, I assume that this reform groups will be independent of the household that own the well or not.
It will be independent of the household. So, you mean if you do not own the, if you don't have a well, then.
Yeah,
so in these experiments, in this pilot, we target only well owners. We did not target non-well owners. It's a good point, and we always struggle with that, how to include them. It's become very difficult, to be too sure. So, there will be spillover to non-well owners as well. That's what we assume, and we can measure that with our end-time survey.
I can tell you that in Bangladesh, the average number of users per well has declined from 11 to 5 households in the area. So that comes close to being the average size of the household. So I think the non-only households are really a small minority at this point, at least in Bangladesh.
What do you think in Indian villages, like in your experience?
In terms of the ownership?
Yes.
So ownership, as I mentioned, you know, some people, they own their own wells,
right,
which they have some shallow tube wells. Now, for example, that's what I'm just thinking aloud is when you say a household. Now, a household can own 2 to 3 wells,
right,
at one hand. On the other hand, a household may not have even a single well.
Right.
So, in these scenarios, you know, how do you take into account preformed rules? That's my question.
So we, our ideal model here is that a household who owns only one well, 2 to 3 wells is relatively unlikely, but yeah, some proportion. It is probably more likely households without any well, for sure, in some poor areas, poor villages. And
you could say the coupon, you know, that you're giving to one sort of the household owning the well, you say, well, you know, it's actually representing all the users of that well. That would be one way to solve that. As you say, all the users of this well agree to share with or, you know, with the neighbors, something like that.
Why I'm just concerned about the unit. So here the unit is, you know, say household.
Household only.
For PhD, the unit is habitation. They're not concerned about households.
Right.
So in terms of looking looking at households, you are basically going by the census data, right?
Right.
Now, census data and NRDW2P data are at loggerheads. They don't talk to each other.
Right.
So, I'm just trying to understand in terms of creating that impact and making it very observable to the government. So, can some unit be identified at a habitation level instead of being at the household? So, when you say, okay, this is the habitation, and in this habitation, these are the number of sources of water. And hence, these are the number of coupons. So, can...
but you are saying like switching across habitats?
Yes, it could be, because what PhD does is PhD does testing in habitation. They don't go to households. Their unit is, when they analyze, they...
What do you mean? Habitation still have households, right? So they eventually can test wells from households, right?
They do, but how they measure is habitations. That's what I'm just...
Generalizing for them.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, we need to think more about that. So I'm just going to give you a brief summary of what other fronts we are going to work on. So you might just talk about this. And all these are important. So first is how to increase the test coverage. It will need some incentivizing for testing. How to increase switching response. It will be more short term. We know that it's short term. And then we have the longer term solution where we have deep wells, publicly funded or privately funded, or some sort of community treatment system. And we are working on all these different fronts. So one other intervention, as I mentioned, that like how to rely on some existing networks. So self-help can be also one important element there. Or for your employees, Aanganwadi workers, or primary school teachers. In a model very similar to Postfolio, basically, so that we can cover all the households in a given area. So which one is going to work? And our idea here is just to give a model to the government. Look, we know you are struggling in how to achieve the blanket testing of all the wells, and here is a model. We tested this with like 100 villages in this state, and it works out very well. So you can probably rely on your network of Aanganwadi workers or teachers, and still achieve the same level of like blanket. And the other one is the fixed way. So because if, as we learned from our field work, that when we employ a tester, a surveyor, and we pay him or her the daily wages, it becomes difficult to make sure that they cover all of the wages. You know, what will the, so if I give a target of 20 tests, I will just pick 20 easiest one, and then I will just leave to the next village. I will not put extra effort because it becomes concave after a certain point, because I will require more, to require to put more effort to find that last household in the village and test. So how to do like different kind of rates and some target or piece rates or fixed rates, which one is going to be more efficient. Then this is about communication. Even placard type, like we have been talking about three placards, but there can be a case where you can only have one placard showing either the unsafe well or showing the safe well, which may have different impact on switching. In that context where there is a big stigma about having a bad well. So in some part of Bihar specifically, they have a report that people don't want to have this placard, and we also saw that in our data. It's like one of the major results in our paper, last year's gene paper, that people try to hide this placard proactively when results are bad. And the reason is that they are concerned that nobody will marry of their daughters in their household, or whatever other kind of like the house value may go down because of arsenic contamination. So all these different kind of concerns are there. So what kind of placards are most favorable in terms of increasing switching rate? That is something which we can test with our international group trial. Or if we can use some more awareness through schools, teachers and students. And the last one is about this private agreement which calls shared interval, where government is not really having, the federal government does not have that kind of resources, or how to optimize location of public defense as we just learned the site hosting So here is a summary of what we want to achieve with this this broad research agenda and with this series of different interventions. We want to find ways to increase the number of testing wells in India at lowest cost. And then evaluate various interventions to increase this low cost, low hanging preventive response, that is switching in this case. And all identify matters to improve this allocation of long term solutions like deep wells or any kind of treatment plant, public deep wells or private deep wells, which can again like provide you the highest efficiency with a given amount of resources. Yes, that's it. We are welcome to more suggestions or feedback as well.